In the previous lesson, we learned a little bit about what statistics was, and we learned about different measures and different variables. In this chapter and in the next chapter, we're going to learn a little bit more about describing the data. In this chapter, we're going to be discussing frequency tables and bar charts and pie charts. The first thing you need to learn about is a frequency table. And a frequency table is just a list of the different categories that you're tracking and the number of occurrences. So with this example that we have here, this might be the class level of the students in this particular statistics class, and then how many there are within each category, and that's called a frequency table. A bar chart, and just to confuse the matter just a little bit here, Excel, if you're creating a chart in Excel, would actually call this a column chart. But a bar chart is just a graphical representation of the frequency distribution. So in this case, we have a column or a bar for each of the different grade levels, freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior, and then the graphical representation of how many there are within each category. A pie chart is another graph that can represent a frequency distribution. In this case, the pie represents 100%, and each of the slices of pie represent the percentage of the category. Now, I don't have the percentages shown in this particular case, but we can just get a graphical representation of sophomores being more than 50% of the entire makeup of the class. Another way that we can look at a frequency distribution is something we call a relative class frequency or relative frequency. And this is kind of a numeric way of displaying a pie chart. If you look at the little sample on this chart, you'll notice that we have 5 freshmen and 16 sophomores, but then we have the relative frequency or the percentage of freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors. And in this case, we can notice that sophomores are 57% of the overall class. Another way to represent a frequency distribution is with a cumulative distribution. And with the slide that you're looking at here, you can see that you have the actual number of each freshman, sophomore, juniors, and seniors, and then the relative frequency, but then you also have the cumulative frequency and the cumulative relative frequency. The cumulative frequency is just the one added to the one before, and then that added to the total. So in this case, we have 5 freshmen, 16 sophomore, so those two together end up with a cumulative frequency of 21 of the 28 total. And by the time we're down to the end of the list, we have all 28 taken care of. In a cumulative relative frequency, we have 18% essentially of freshmen, and then we add that to the 57% of sophomores, we end up with 75% with those two together. We add juniors in, we have 89% of the class taken care of. Finally, we add the seniors, and now we have 100% of the class represented on the frequency distribution. If you think back to the last lesson, you might recall the difference between discrete or whole number variables and continuous variables where we could have any value. Now, in the example that we had before with freshmen, sophomore, juniors, and seniors with our frequency distribution, we just had 4 categories. Now, if we were using numeric data, as this slide shows, to have one frequency for every value, $11, $11.20, $11.30, it would be very, very confusing. So when we're dealing with numeric data, when we're coming up with a frequency distribution, most often we come up with a range of values, like between $10 and $12, and then count how many individuals were paid that much in this particular survey. And those are called classes. And so the next couple of slides are going to show you how we actually would set up a frequency distribution using numeric data. So this slide shows you how we could actually make sense of all that data that we were seeing with the different pays reported by the individuals in their surveys. So we have ranges, and then we have the number within that particular range. And the next couple of slides will actually give you the steps that we can use to create this on your own. So our first step in creating a frequency distribution table with numeric values is to decide on the number of categories or classes, and we designate those with the letter K. So a useful formula that we can use is 2 to the power of k should be greater than the number of people in the survey, or in items in that survey, people in this case. So there were 421 people in that survey, so in this case n is 21. So we might try k as 8, and k to the 8th power would be 256, which is less than the 421, so we're not going to use 8. So then we try 9. You know, k to the 9th power is 512. Now that is larger than 421. And so using this particular formula in the book, we would use an example. We would select 9 categories or nine classes. However, we're going to use 10 for that. And the reason that we're going to use 10 for that is we're going to compute this in Excel. And on this website, you'll have a demo on how to do that in Excel as well once you're done with this PowerPoint. But Excel actually uses a slightly different rule and comes up with 10. So we're going to use 10 classes, but we could also use 9, and that would work just as well for us. Okay, after deciding how many intervals you're going to have, or how many classes or categories, if you will, which we called K, the next step is to actually determine the interval or the width. And so using our pay survey as our example, are we going to have between 9 and 11 or 9 and 15? And there's a very simple formula that we use to do that. Now remember, we decided on using a K of 10, even though using that simple formula, it came up with 9. And again, the reason for that is we're using Excel as our tool here. So the interval must be greater than or equal to the highest value minus the lowest value divided by K. So the highest value in that pay survey, which you haven't seen yet, is $27.10. The lowest value is 9. We divide that by 10 and we come up with $1.81. Well, we're going to round it up to the nearest dollar, in this case 2. So we're going to use a class width of 2, from 9 to 11. So the third step, once we know how many classes we're going to have and what the width or the interval is to actually go ahead and create the categories. So using our pay survey as an example, 9 to 11, 11 to 13, 13 to 15, and all the way to 27 to 29, as you can see in this slide. After you've determined how many classes you're going to have and what the range is going to be and have built the classes, the next step is to go ahead and do a count. And obviously, if you're dealing with several thousand, you wouldn't want to do this manually. That's where tools like Microsoft Excel come in very, very handy. And like I said, there will be a demonstration after this PowerPoint that you can go in and actually see how this was done in Excel. Well, that was pretty easy, wasn't it? Really nothing too difficult there. You can see different ways to describe data. In this case, we primarily talked about frequency distributions. And just remember, as I mentioned in the intro, we are going to continue to build with these different topics. So if you get stuck on anything, make sure you do contact me and make sure that things get cleared up before you continue on. So do look at the demonstration video on how to create that in Excel and do the assigned homework for you this particular lesson.